Good day to everyone here. I'll be speaking on current modalities in the treatment of rheumatoid arthritis. If we look at the clinical course of rheumatoid arthritis, as we know, is a polyarticular disease, primarily causing arthritis affecting hand joints, foot joints, and the other joints in the body. A person is said to be having rheumatoid if he or she satisfies 4 of the 7 criteria, with criteria 1 to 4 being present for at least 6 weeks. Classically, a patient of rheumatoid arthritis has morning stiffness, arthritis of three or more joints, arthritis of hand joints. This is very important because in 95% of patients of rheumatoid arthritis, hand joints are involved. So if you have a patient who doesn't have hand joint involvement, always review what is the diagnosis. That arthritis is usually symmetric, rheumatoid nodules, serum rheumatoid factor. Point to note is that 30% the patients will not have rheumatoid factor, but can have aggressive rheumatoid arthritis. Point to be noted. Radiographic changes like periarticular osteopenia. Now, when we look at the management of rheumatoid arthritis, there are certain key principles. We must diagnose rheumatoid arthritis early. When I was training in Nottingham University, I observed that they had an early arthritis clinic. Now, people who have arthritis, who are having arthritis in the first 6 weeks of their illness, they are referred to the early arthritis clinic. So, basic aim is to pick RA early and start treatment with DMRs early for better outcome. Initiate DMRs, disease-modifying anti-rheumatic drugs, at the time of diagnosis. This is very important. Once you make the diagnosis, there is no reason why treatment with DMR should be delayed. Treat to target. This is very important. You are aiming for low disease activity, remission. So, you have a target in your mind and you treat. This is very important. You can't just treat haphazardly. For most patients, methotrexate will be the cornerstone of DMR therapy. Methotrexate is the key drug. It is the bread and butter drug of a rheumatologist. In refractory disease, you need combinations of DMRs with or without biologics to achieve the target. Now, if we look at the 2019 EULAR guidelines, we have... Once you have diagnosed rheumatoid arthritis and there is no contraindication for methotrexate, we start methotrexate. We can combine with short-term glucocorticoids. It's called bridge therapy. So, normally in the practice, we would give injection methylprednisolone acetate 80 mg intramuscularly weekly for 4 weeks along with methotrexate. We can start with 10 and after 2 to 4 weeks increase it to 15 mg and then go on to increase further. If there is a contraindication to methotrexate, then we can start with leflunomide or sulfasalazine. Now, furthermore, you look, if they have improved at 3 months and achieved targets at 6 months, then you continue. And later on, if patient is doing well, let us say at 17.5 milligram of methotrexate, we can even bring down the dose to 15 milligram. Now, if you look at the phase two, if there are poor prognostic factors present like anti-cyclic citrullinated peptide at high levels, high disease activity, early joint damage failure. In that case, add a biological DMR or a JAK kinase inhibitor. And then you can follow up. If the poor prognostic factors are absent, change to or add a second conventional synthetic DMR like leflunomide, sulfasalazine or DMR combination with glucocorticoids. If you remember, the classic O'Dell regime combines methotrexate, sulfasalazine and hydroxychloroquine. That is one of the classic regime. There was a trial called COBRA trial by Desiree van der Heide, where they used full dose, they used methotrexate, sulfasalazine, hydroxychloroquine with steroids, and they found that these are the patients actually who did very well. So, you can have a step down approach also, but these are the EULAR guidelines. So just thought of sharing that with you. What kind of arrows do we have in our arsenal? We have disease-modifying anti-rheumatic drugs, which are synthetic. Then we have the biologicals. The synthetic include conventional synthetic DMRs, then targeted synthetic DMRs, bio-originator DMRs, or biologics as they are called, and biosimilars DMRs. Now, conventional synthetic obviously are the key drugs. They are the ones which are going to be used in the maximum number of patients. Here I am showing a photograph of Professor Anand Malviya. He was the head of Department of Rheumatology in AIIMS, New Delhi. He is my grand teacher and my teacher. He is one of the, persons. When he was in Boston, somewhere in late 60s, he was working in the team which actually started using methotrexate in dermatomyositis. So that is the point to understand that, previously methotrexate was not used. It's only later on when, it started being used, and then we came to know how useful it is. Only thing is, high dose methotrexate, which is doses in grams administered in cycles, and those which cause the two key enzymes, dihydrofolate reductase and TYMS suppression, and they are used in the treatment of malignancy. Whereas low dose methotrexate, the dose we use in rheumatoid arthritis is 10 milligram. We can go up to 30 milligrams weekly. It has a basically, and point to note is that inhibits enzymes ICART only, but not dihydrofolate reductase and TYMS. That's a point to keep in mind. Methotrexate is a synthetic non-biologic anti-metabolite, inhibits AICAR and thymidylate synthetase, inhibition of inflammation by suppression of macrophages, dendritic cells, lymphocytes, neutrophils, and stimulation of apoptosis in these cells. This is a point to keep in mind. Usually, basically we give it once a week. You start with 10 milligram per week, can be increased up to 25 milligram per week. When we were somewhere in 2003, I remember when Dr. Ravinder Mani, he is the person who was behind, the doctor behind infliximab. He had come to the Army Hospital R&R, and I was training at AIIMS that time. So when we met him, one thing we learned from him was, which we realized was, he said that you don't have to waste too much time to increase from 10 to 15. So a lot of people would be at 10 for a long time, for maybe 6 weeks, 8 weeks. Don't, he says, in 2 to 3 weeks, you should go to the higher dose. So that's point, and we should try to keep at 15. Earlier, when I started treating rheumatoid, we used to start with 7.5 milligram and then go to 10. No, now it's not like that. You go at, start with 10, move very fast to 15 and then move up. And you can give oral subcutaneous. A point to, actually the 21 guidelines of the American College of Rheumatology have just come and have come and, and we are in the, we have also read them. Now, like, one thing is that, methotrexate, they prefer that you give oral, but once you cross 15, like 17.5, 20, 25, it is better to give intramuscular subcutaneously. And you can even split methotrexate into two, like people who are having gastritis or something. You can split it 7.5 morning, 7.5 evening, but you have to take it within 24 hours, that dose. And you, along with folic acid, 5 milligram. Common side effects are hepatotoxicity, nausea, vomiting, hair loss, and mucositis. It's contraindicated in pregnancy and active infections. Methotrexate side effects can be minimized by splitting the dose of oral methotrexate over a 24-hour period, taking weekly subcutaneous injections instead of oral methotrexate, or taking extra folic acid. Since it is a key drug, every effort should be made to try to sustain with methotrexate by splitting or by switching over to subcutaneous or intramuscular. Now, there will be a lot of questions people will ask you. This is one common thing, which I have seen. They will ask, can I drink alcohol? No. How long does it take to work? 4 to 6 weeks it will start. Is it a cancer drug? Yes, but not in the dose which we are giving. Why do I have to take folic acid? You all know that. Will it mess up my immune system? You have to tell that this dose, immunosuppressive effect will be there, but not that severe. So, the dose matters. Now, how to follow up a patient on methotrexate? You should do baseline liver function test, creatinine, chest, complete blood count, chest x-ray and viral markers. It's very important that you do an x-ray, because in a country like India, if somebody is harboring tuberculosis, you would not like to give methotrexate. Similarly, viral markers like hepatitis B, anti-HCV, they should be negative. You would like to look at that, you know. And repeat OTPT once a month for 3 months and then once in 3 months. This is an important point to be kept in mind. Nausea, vomiting, then change to subcutaneous or split the dose. We discussed this. If elevated liver enzymes are there, more than 3 times upper limit, stop methotrexate and restart at a lower dose once enzymes become normal. Less than 3 times the upper limit of normal, reduce methotrexate and repeat LFT after a week. This is a point to be noted. Like, suppose the cutoff level is 40 units. If the SGPT has gone to say 180, then you should stop and restart at a lower dose once enzymes come back to normal. But if it is just from 40 to 70, you don't have to stop it. You can reduce from 15, you can come down to 12.5 and repeat after a week and see and follow up. Now, leflunomide is a dihydroorotate dehydrogenase inhibitor. Its inhibition of T cell proliferation and production of autoantibody by B cells also decreases IL-8 and interleukin 10 synthesis and TNF-alpha dependent non-NFKB activation. Inhibits bony damage along with methotrexate. It's contraindicated in pregnancy. So, in women of childbearing age group, you should be very cautious when you are using leflunomide. One point to be kept in mind, you can also do a cholestyramine washout if toxicity occurs, where you give cholestyramine 8 grams 3 times a day for 11 days. So that can reduce the levels very fast also, especially when they cause side effects like bone marrow depression and all. So you start with 10 milligram, increase to 20 milligram per day if needed. Synergistic action with methotrexate. Diarrhea can occur with this drug in some patients. Weight gain, increase in blood pressure can occur. More risk of hepatotoxicity if used with methotrexate. Keep that in mind. So when you are using methotrexate and leflunomide together, you have to be very cautious. Keep a very close eye on the LFTs. Sulfasalazine is another useful drug, metabolized to sulfapyridine and 5-aminosalicylic acid. 5-ASA, sulfapyridine is the active moiety in rheumatoid arthritis treatment. Mechanism of action, it decreases the production of IgA and IgM, inhibits release of inflammatory cytokines produced by macrophages and monocytes. Example, interleukin 1, 6, 12 and TNF-alpha. Now, how to use? You normally start with 500 milligrams twice daily, say for, 3 days, then give 500 thrice a day for, say, another 3 days. And then come to the full dose of 1 gram twice daily. It is less effective than methotrexate. GI upset, there is a risk of DRESS syndrome, but it is safe in pregnancy. This is a point to be noted, which where methotrexate, leflunomide, you cannot use. Sulfasalazine, HCQS will be better. Same hydroxychloroquine, again, mechanism of action is suppression of T lymphocyte response to mitogens. Effects, decreases leukocyte chemotaxis, stabilization of lysosomal enzymes and trapping of free radicals. You normally start with, weight will, you see the weight and give the drug. And normally you start with 200 to 300 milligrams and you can give 200 milligram twice daily for 3 months, then come down to 200 milligram daily. It's an add-on drug. It's usually only for mild cases of rheumatoid you can use as a single drug. Otherwise, it will always be part of a combination drug therapy. It can cause retinal toxicity, again safe in pregnancy. See, when we look at the drugs, we have the non-biologic era where we had methotrexate, sulfasalazine, hydroxychloroquine, d-penicillamine, gold, cyclosporine A, azathioprine, and then later 98 leflunomide came. Then 2000 we had infliximab, and then anakinra in 2001, adalimumab in 2003, abatacept in 2005, rituximab in 2006, golimumab etc. in 2009, and targeted small molecule, the JAK kinase inhibitors in the period around 210 to 16, tofacitinib and baricitinib in this group. Now, infliximab we very well know is an anti-TNF antibody. It's a Kimra. part murine and part human. Adalimumab, golimumab, cetrolizumab, these are all, you know, humanized. And abatacept basically is a co-st- it causes co-stimulatory blockade. Rituximab is anti-CD20, so B-cell targeting. Anakinra is an interleukin-1 receptor antagonist, and tocilizumab is an interleukin-6 receptor blocker. Not only in rheumatoid, we all have seen in recently has been very useful in cytokine storm in, you know, patients of COVID. Now, you know, this is a diagram which basically shows where they act. The abatacept is basically, or CD8086 is the target. We have already discussed this more or less. And we have these, you know, JAK kinase inhibitors, very important group. And now it's, you know, coming in a big way. Now, when we look at the basically, I think methotrexate, leflunomide, sulfasalazine, chloroquine, we have more or less covered their mechanism. And infliximab, as we discussed, is a TNF-alpha inhibitor. One point to be kept in mind is that, you know, when we started using in, you know, 2002-03 was the time when I personally started using infliximab, we found a lot of tuberculosis cases. The number was not very high, but in the sense one realized that one has to be very careful in a country like India. So you have to be rule out the, you know, pulmonary tuberculosis, and, you know, do an ultrasound abdomen. You know, it's better to be very careful. That care you have to take with the all these drugs, you know. And in anaphylactoid, transfusion reactions can also occur, and they can develop infections. Not only tuberculosis, even pneumonia, bacterial can occur. Rituximab and all, comparatively, this problem is less of tuberculosis because of the B-cell it is targeting. In the B-cell targeted therapy, belimumab is also there. It's another drug. T-cell targeted, as I discussed, abatacept is important drug. Again, they can cause infections. Same with tocilizumab, with interleukin-6 inhibition can cause inhibitions, can cause infections. And secukinumab, you have to keep in mind, is an interleukin-17 inhibitor. Again, infections, candidiasis can occur. Then growth and differentiation factors like denosumab, it targets the Rankl inhibitor, and mavrilimumab, GM-CSF inhibitor. JAK pathway, tofacitinib, it's a good drug. Basically, again, zoster infection is one of the side effects. Now, dofacitinib is JAK1 and JAK3 inhibitor, and JAK1 and JAK2 inhibitor is baricitinib. And future drugs and targets are like toll-like receptors, Bruton's tyrosine kinase, phosphoinositide 3 kinase pathway, dendritic cell, neuropathways, and transforming growth factor beta. Now, regarding steroids, you know, steroids are often, basically, you have to remember, are given as a short-term treatment. Now, you never start steroid as the only treatment for rheumatoid. That's a point to understand. As a bridge therapy, short period, taper and stop. To deal with flares, that's a point to understand. Whenever a flare will occur, you may use intra-articular or intramuscular also. Exceptions are rheumatoid vasculitis may require high-dose steroids. According to ULR-15 and ACR-21 guidelines, every newly diagnosed patient should be treated as soon as possible using methotrexate and avoid glucocorticoids as much as possible. So, you have to use minimum possible. This is very important. And precautions while using steroids, don't use steroids as monotherapy, not more than 15 mg to start with per day. Most require 10 mg per day only. Taper as soon as possible, 3 to 6 months only, once daily dosing after breakfast for obvious reasons. Don't give steroids at bedtime. We all know that. Now, I'll just share a small clinical scenario. A 67-year-old lady comes to you with a 10-week history of bilateral wrist pain and swelling of right-sided second and third MCP and left-sided second MCP. CRP is elevated, rheumatoid factor and anti-CCP is positive. So what would you do? Observe, start NSAIDs and keep under follow-up. C, start DMARD/DMARDs. So obviously, we will start therapy with DMARDs as soon as the diagnosis of RA is made. So the picture is quite clear. Why we should wait? Annual medical cost for patients with rheumatoid arthritis, one can very well see that, you know, once biologic DMARDs are used, the cost will be very high. So that's why the old molecules are always very important. So we can, by and large, you know, our therapy concepts are more or less, I think, clear by this time. A word about pregnancy, lactation and rheumatoid. Stop methotrexate 3 months before pregnancy or when they are planning pregnancy. Leflunomide is better avoided in childbearing age group. Sulfasalazine, hydroxychloroquine and prednisolone less than 15 milligram per day are safe in pregnancy. Biologics role is controversial, but definitely in the first 12 weeks you will avoid. After 13 weeks you can use. We have used etanercept and all, really with good results. Now, as regards infections, stop DMARDs whenever there is acute infections. In chronic infections like hepatitis B, sulfasalazine is safer. And steroids do not stop abruptly whenever patient is having because of risk of Addisonian crisis. So, I'll now come to the take-home messages. Diagnose early, treat early to prevent damage. Use steroids for the shortest possible duration. Methotrexate is the cornerstone drug in this treatment of rheumatoid arthritis. Thank you very much.